got some information that might interest you.
I'll be with you in just a minute.
One of the witnesses has a lot of proof backing up the story.
What's that, man? It's an obvious fraud. Australopithecus efferensis? Nothing but a chimpanzee. Neanderthal man? A deformed human. I can't believe he's still using that old story.
Yeah, but look at what the other witness says. He claims that men live to be over 900 years old.
900 years?
Yeah.
That's not possible.
Yes, it is.
Is it possible for people to live over 900 years? The Bible says Adam lived to be 930. Methuselah was 969. The average age before the flood was 912. How on earth can you live to be 900 years old? What did they eat before the flood? And where'd all the water from the flood go anyway? Where'd it come from? When did dinosaurs live anyway? So what about the dinosaurs? Where did they live? Is it possible that men have seen dinosaurs all along? Why do we see dinosaurs put on ancient pottery? Why are they carved on cave walls and find the walls of the Grand Canyon, do we find dinosaurs? Indians hunted them. I mean, would you want to stand up in front of God and everybody and defend the idea that we all came from a rock? How many of you have been taught that all the continents used to fit together in one big supercontinent called Pangaea? I bet they never told you they shrank Africa 40% to make them fit, did they? But there's no question the Earth is busted up in plates. And there's no question the plates are moving a little bit. The question is, when did this happen? I think it happened about 4,400 years ago at the flood in the days of Noah. And the poor kids in school today are taught over millions of years these plates have moved away from one supercontinent called Pangaea. They don't tell the kids they shrank Africa 40% to make those continents fit. They also don't tell them that Mexico and Central America are gone. They also don't tell them the obvious, that if you took the water out of the oceans, you would notice there is dirt underneath. These continents are not floating around like lily pads in a bathtub, folks, okay? They are connected. Water above the atmosphere? Psalm 148 says, "Praise Him, ye waters that be above the heavens." See, the atmosphere that we're breathing today comes in six layers. Troposphere, stratosphere, mesosphere, thermosphere, exosphere, and ionosphere. There used to be a seventh layer. It was a layer of water above the atmosphere. Now, this is what is known as the canopy theory. I cannot prove this. I can just tell you what the Bible says. There was water above the atmosphere, and I'm going to believe the Bible until it's proven wrong. Okay? I can't tell you what it was or how it was held up there. Some people think it was ice, and it was held up by the magnetic field of the Earth. Suspended, what's called the Meissner effect. You know, a magnet will float on top of another magnet. I don't know. Somehow there was water up there. The theory is that this canopy of water or ice would probably be 10 or 20 miles up, and it would double the air pressure here on Earth. This would increase air pressure and filter out UV light. So the canopy theory says probably we had greater air pressure because of this canopy over the top, and the whole Earth was like a big greenhouse. Not only that, there was more water under the crust of the Earth. If you read carefully, you'll see in Psalm 136, God said he stretched out the earth above the waters. That's an interesting verse. Psalm 24 says he founded it upon the seas. Did you know when God first made the earth, there was water inside the crust of the earth or under the crust? Maybe, I don't pick a number, say 10 miles down, there's subterranean water chambers. That's probably the water that came shooting to the surface when the fountains of the deep broke open. Obviously. Did you know an 80-foot apatosaurus has nostrils the same size as a horse? How on earth would an 80-foot animal get enough air through nostrils the same size as a horse? Well, sometimes in these amber pockets, there are air bubbles. The air bubbles have 50% more oxygen than we do today. Because under those conditions, what happens is not only does your hemoglobin take on oxygen in your bloodstream, your plasma will get oxygen saturated, which means you could run for hundreds of miles without getting tired. I think before the flood came, things were just a lot different, okay? Probably double the air pressure, increased oxygen. Oh, it'd just be a lot different. It would sure make you heal up faster. How many of you remember baby Jessica that fell down in the well in Texas back in 87? She was down there for 2.5 days. It was an amazing rescue. When they finally got her out of there, lots of her body had turned black from lack of circulation. One doctor said, we have to cut her leg off immediately because it's all black from no circulation. Another doctor said, hey, before we start cutting things off, let's try putting her in a hyperbaric oxygen chamber. Normally, they used to use these just for scuba divers. If they come up too fast, they get the bends, they pressurize them, you know, to get rid of the air bubbles in the blood. They put Jessica in one of these chambers, filled it up full of pure oxygen, and pumped it up to double normal pressure. Within a few hours, her leg turned pink. They restored circulation. In West Germany, they're treating stroke patients with hyperbaric oxygen and getting incredible healing from strokes. In England, they're treating multiple sclerosis. Many diseases around the world are now being treated with just hyperbaric oxygen, adding air pressure, finding unbelievable results. Probably the whole world had that before the flood. You wouldn't need a chamber. You just, the whole world, you're living in it the whole time. In India, they're treating leprosy with hyperbaric oxygen. Here's a kid being treated for cerebral palsy with a hyperbaric oxygen hood. There's a clinic in Dallas that give you hydrogen peroxide in your water to drink, and it helps most diseases get better. Dr. Kimori in Japan started raising tomato plants with a special filter that filtered out UV light. He got a machine that follows the sun all day, and it sends light down fiber optic cable, and he sprays light on his plants. They set it up for Expo 85 in Japan over there, and someone told me that he also pressurized carbon dioxide to the stem of the plant. I haven't been able to verify that, but I've had several folks tell me, yes, that's correct, but I've searched and I can't find the facts. I was in Japan, didn't get to talk to them. But see, plants breathe CO2, and if you can pressurize carbon dioxide to the plant, of course, they're going to get more of what they need to grow faster. They expected Dr. Kimori's tomato plant might produce 10,000 tomatoes. It kept growing and growing and growing under this special light, got to be 40 feet tall. When it was 2 years old, it was only 16 feet tall and produced 900 tomatoes. I was debating a woman, Eugenia Scott. She's the president of an organization designed to keep creation out of schools. That's all they do. I was on a radio debate with her one time, and she said, Dr. Hovind, there are 80 separate layers of coal in the Midwest. She's right. She said, if you look at the amount of coal in the world, the entire biomass, that means all the plants of the world today, could not possibly be converted to that much fossil fuel. She's right again. She said there had to have been an enormous amount of time. Right there is where she's wrong. See, she's assuming the world today is like it was before the flood, and that's a common mistake people make. One professor said, Hovind, if there was a worldwide flood, where did it all go? Where's all that water? I said, well, it's still here. It's out in the oceans. They're huge. There's enough water out there right now to cover the earth a mile and a half deep everywhere. But this canopy of water over the earth would block out UV light. It would block out X-rays. See, the sun puts off a lot of stuff besides light. It puts off X-rays and gamma rays and beta rays. X-rays particularly are dangerous. But you go to the hospital to get an X-ray, and he puts this weird machine on top of you, and he says, okay, now take a deep breath. Hold it. And he runs out in the hall. He says, hey, wait, Doc, come here. Is this machine dangerous? He says, no, it's harmless. He says, if it's harmless, Doc, how come you got a lead apron on and you're running out behind a lead-plated wall? The sun is X-raying us every day of our life, except on cloudy days, because water stops X-rays. Before the flood, they lived over 900 years. One guy travels around, he claims to be a creationist. He says, you know, they didn't really live to be 900 years old. They counted every month as a year. You have to divide their age by 12. Wow. That's an even bigger miracle. You know, Enoch was 65 when he begat Methuselah. Two of these guys were 65. Let's see, divided by 12? He's 5 and a half when he became a daddy. I don't think so. No, they were living to be 900. Yes, they really were. Okay. Were there really giants on the earth over 10 feet tall? The Bible says there were giants in the earth in those days. I think it says that because there were giants in the earth in those days. Here's me by Robert Wadlow, tallest man in this century. That's a statue. He died in 1940, but he's almost nine feet tall. 8'11¼". Here's Robert with his dad and his brother. Family portrait. Big fella. Robert was 5'6" when he was 5 years old. When he was 12, he was the world's tallest Boy Scout at 7'4". He weighed 500 and some pounds. Doesn't look fat, does he? We would say, man, that guy's gigantic. Well, I think maybe before the flood, they got even bigger than that. Here's a skeleton of a man, 11 feet, 6 inches tall. Well, long, not tall. He's laying down now. But I bet you didn't hear about the skeletons found in Indiana back in 1879. 9'8" tall. Now, why would they not tell you about that in your public school textbook? Could it be that somebody wants you to believe a theory which says, man, used to be itty-bitty and we're getting bigger and better, and, you know, this kind of evidence kind of upsets the theory, so we'll just kind of ignore that? Or did you hear about the ones in Virginia City, Nevada? 2 skeletons, 9 feet tall, found in Virginia City. Or the one in Humboldt Lake, Nevada, 10 feet tall. How about the one in Indiana? They found 8 giants ranging from 8 to 9 feet long, wearing heavy copper armor. Through the bungling of the diggers and the disinterest of the museum establishment, the discoveries were scattered and lost. Why would the museum not be interested in 8 and 9 foot tall skeletons? How about the 12-foot skeleton found by soldiers in Lompoc Rancho, California? Or the 12-foot skeleton found in Tucson, Arizona? The guy had 6 toes, a long hair, and a bird-shaped headdress. The Smithsonian, believe it or not, has been responsible for hiding lots of these discoveries. I want to get this far out adventures, and I don't believe everything these guys write. They got some weirdo stuff in here. But they have some amazing article about the Smithsonian, and they're covering up stuff on giants that are found. There's one in a giant skull on display right now in Nevada. Winnemucca, Nevada. If you're ever driving across, be sure to stop, because there's nothing else to see as you go across Nevada. This is a normal human thumb bone right here. Underneath is a giant human thumb bone. This comes from Mount Ararat in Turkey. The government of Turkey claims they have found the grave of Noah. The skeleton was 12 feet tall. Here's a replica right here of a giant thigh bone found in Egypt. The guy would have been close to 12 and a half feet tall. If you ever meet a guy who's got one of these, you call him Sir. The Bible says there were giants in the earth in those days. I believe it says that because there were giants in the earth in those days. By the way, the Christians that read their Bible have always known the earth is round. Okay, it was only a few heathen a few hundred years ago that said the earth was flat. in 1922, a guy named Harold Cook found one tooth in Sioux County, Nebraska, right by the Colorado border. He thought that to him, this tooth looked like it was halfway between the shape of a human tooth and an ape's tooth. All he found was one tooth. So he constructed an entire man from one tooth. Then he built the guy a wife. You have to really be good to know what his wife looks like from the shape of his tooth, but these are professionals, so don't question them. They had them on display in the books, you know, Piltdown or Nebraska Man and his wife. Later, they found out the tooth actually came from a pig. Let's talk about Piltdown Man. There's a place in England called Piltdown, England. This whole thing was a fraud, okay? A Catholic priest named Pierre de Chardin and a couple of other guys, nobody's exactly sure who all was involved in this, but they took a human skull and an ape's jawbone, they filed them down and made them fit together, treated them with acid to make them look old, and took them out and buried them in a gravel pit. And then later they discovered the Piltdown Man. It was in the textbooks for 40 years. It was a hoax. 500 papers, master's degrees and doctor's degree papers, were written on the Piltdown Man. What about Neanderthal Man? Well, Neanderthal Man is named after the Neander Valley where it was found back in 1856. And in that valley back in 1856, they found a skeleton of a man. And they said, wow, this guy's back has bent over. It must be some poor soul that drowned in the flood. 4 years later, Charles Darwin's book was written, 1859, or 3 years later. And people began looking for evidence for evolution. And so everybody originally thought the Neanderthal man was just a human, okay, drowned in the flood, probably. But after a while, they couldn't find any evidence for evolution, so they started resurrecting stuff they'd previously found and said, well, we better call this evidence for evolution. Because man walks on two legs and apes walk on four, this guy's back was bent over. And they said, wow, look at that, he's evolving, he's slowly coming up. No, they proved about 50 years ago, it was just an old man with arthritis, he's slowly going down. And quite a few Neanderthals have been found all over Europe. The bones in their forehead were a little thicker than ours, but their brain size was actually bigger than ours. And their bone structure indicates they were so strong The average Neanderthal could probably pick up the average NFL linebacker and throw him over the goalpost. There is no indication they were dumb or primitive. They were incredibly intelligent, incredibly strong race of people here on this planet. Just humans, probably humans that were living to be 300 or 400 years old. Because as you get older, the bones in the forehead get thicker. Your ears get longer. Nose gets bigger. How many have seen older folks like that, you know? That stuff kind of happens to them. Called acromegaly. Jack Guazzo is a dentist from New Jersey. He went over to Europe and studied most of the original actual Neanderthals that are in the museums. He brought with x-ray equipment, x-rayed them. He found out they put them together horribly incorrectly. They wanted them to look ape-like, so they took one and took the jaw and moved it out of the socket almost an inch. So it looked like it had a sloping head. He said, this did not even set in the socket, fellas. Put it back in the socket, looks just like a normal human. So they reconstruct these fragments of bones with based on their preconceived idea. Guazzo said, after examining the famous Rhodesia man, he said, you must understand this skull really cries out disease. The teeth are badly decayed, the bones of the vault of the skull are extremely thick. There are many features that testify of acromegaly, excessive growth hormone, in old age. We've got another one in our textbooks here in Escambia County, Florida, called Australopithecus afarensis, more commonly known as Lucy. Donald Johansson found Lucy in 1974, Hadar Valley, Ethiopia. He found these little bones and put it together. He found 40% of the skeleton. Lucy was about 3 feet tall. It was obviously a chimpanzee, a monkey of some kind. But they put Lucy's skull in the textbooks today as if it is half human, half ape. The head was too thoroughly crushed, they couldn't tell what they had for a head. Very few bones. All you need is a good imagination to make a missing link. But the big thing that triggered his imagination was Lucy's knee joint. He said the thigh bone angled off to the side. See, on a human, your lower leg comes up straight, and then the thigh bone angles off to the side because your hips are wider than your knees. On an ape, their upper and lower leg are in a straight line. And he said, Lucy's knee is angled off to the side. That proves she's becoming a human. Well, in the first place, National Geographic labeled this one, which is actually the Hadar knee. It was found a year earlier, 70 meters, that's 200 feet lower in a different layer of rock, okay, and a mile and a half away. This is not from Lucy, unless the train hit her going about 400 miles an hour, okay? Five times National Geographic labeled it Lucy's knee, and it's not even Lucy's knee. Tom Willis has a great article about Lucy Goes to College, about the real facts about Lucy's knee, and how Johansson has very conveniently just been real quiet about this, okay? That's not Lucy's knee. But he said the angle femur proves she's becoming a human. Well, now, hold on, Donald. Every monkey that climbs trees has an angle femur. It's ground-dwelling monkeys that have the straight femur. Angled femur might just mean a tree-climbing monkey. So that's not proof it's becoming a human. He said, well, you know, the bones are slightly bigger than a regular ape. Well, yeah, they were just a little bit bigger than a regular ape, but that doesn't prove anything. They found footprints in Laetoli, Africa. They said the form of the foot was exactly the same as ours. Footprints so very much like our own. This is a National Geographic. Here they found perfectly normal human footprints in the ash. Russell Tuttle from University of Chicago studied more than 70 people that habitually go barefoot. They walk barefoot all their life, and their foot gets wider. If you go barefoot all your life, your foot gets wider. Okay? He studied 70 people that go barefoot all their life, and he compared those footprints that they left to footprints left in ash in Africa and could find no difference whatsoever. They were identical to people that go barefoot all their life. If the footprints were not known to be so old, we could readily conclude they were made by a member of our own genus, Homo. The expert on australopithecines is probably Dr. Charles Ochsner, who did computer multivariate analysis of all of the bones. He said, folks, I'm sorry, after studying Lucy for 16 years, I'll say these australopithecines are more different than apes and humans than the latter are from each other. They're not a missing link at all. They're just an unusual monkey. And there might be some still alive. What about the Peking man, named after Peking, China? They won't tell you that they also found 10 humans in the same area. They've got one in your textbooks now called Homo erectus. Kids are going to be taught about this tomorrow. They're going to be tested on it and quizzed on it. Homo erectus. Originally known as Java man, then later Pithecanthropus erectus, meaning erect ape man, and now called Homo erectus. It's dated by the evolutionists at 500,000 years old. It was made from a few scraps of bone found in 1891 in Java, Indonesia. Dutch anatomist Dubose took an ape's skull cap, three human teeth, plus a thigh bone found a year later and 50 feet away from a human, and informed the world he had found the missing link. He hid the fact that he also found two normal human skulls in the same area. Did you know there's no such thing as prehistoric? That word was made up in the early 1900s after evolution became a popular theory. Go get some old dictionaries and look up the word prehistoric. I got a dictionary from 1766, and prehistoric was not in it. There was no such word. Got a dictionary from 1860. Guess what? Prehistoric was not there. If you could talk to the folks from the Civil War and say, what about prehistoric times? They would say, prehistoric, what is that? There's no such thing. There are things that are pre-flood, but that's not prehistoric. See, we have history right from day one. The Bible says, in the beginning. Dinosaur and human bones have been found together. Here's the stones from Ica, Peru, where they found people riding dinosaurs. Dr. Ball has a couple of the stones, so does Don Patton. You can get the website bible.ca/tracks in CA for Canada. If you want to see pictures of the Ica stones, or if you're going across Texas, stop and see some there. Glen Rose, they've got some on display there. Every known dinosaur is found depicted on these Ica stones. But in this town of Glen Rose, there's a river that runs through there called the Paluxy River. Back in 1908, the Paluxy flooded, which is nothing unusual. It's the second to the fastest moving river in Texas. It drops 17 feet per mile. To put that in perspective, the Mississippi drops 8 inches per mile. The Paluxy drops 17 feet per mile. Rapidly moving river when it rains. When it quits raining, it dries up. If you go in August, oftentimes rivers bone dry, August or September. not always, but, you know, check before, call before you go. But in 1908, the river flooded. The whole area is limestone layers. The flood went through town 27 feet above flood stage. It went through so fast, it ripped off the bottom of the river. 2 feet of solid limestone was ripped off and moved downstream, exposing another layer of limestone underneath. In that new layer of limestone, they found hundreds and hundreds of dinosaur footprints. There were so many dinosaur footprints, they made a state park. Still there today, Dinosaur Valley State Park. During the 1930s, they sent people down there to chisel out the footprints. It's one of the work projects to keep people working, and, you know, the socialist projects they started here in America as we slowly became communist. They found human footprints with the dinosaur footprints. Now, I've read all the controversy back and forth on both sides of this issue, and I've been there myself and studied it. They're really legitimate. One of the good human tracks, as it wore down, grew 2 toes and became a 3-toed dinosaur print. They even found a petrified hammer. One lady broke open a lump of coal in Illinois, and there was a gold chain inside, 10 inches long. Human artifacts found in coal. This iron pot, I've got a replica of it here on the table. You're going to come see this. Iron pot found inside solid coal. Colorado found human bones and a copper arrowhead in a vein of silver. In 1880, J.D. Whitney, the state geologist of California, published a lengthy review of advanced stone tools found in California gold mines, including implements, including spear points, mortars, and pestles. When they found the coelacanth, they'd been teaching the kids this thing's been extinct for 70 million years. They found live ones in the Indian Ocean. They said, wow, look, they survived for 70 million years. Did you know the Bible gives us the cure for cancer and heart attacks and strokes? It's all right there in the Bible. God said, Adam, I want you to eat the fruit, the vegetables, and the seeds. When you eat a peach, you should eat the seed. It looks like an almond, and it tastes terrible. But if you eat the seeds to the fruit, you will get a vitamin that you won't get in the fruit. The vitamin is called vitamin B17. B17 is found in the seeds, not in the fruit. And people that get lots of B17 in their diet don't get cancer. Love of money, root of all evil. Remember that? Okay. Average age of medical doctors in America is 58 when they die. Certain grasses have B17. Have you ever seen a dog or a cat get sick and go eat grass? Do you know wild animals never get cancer? Zoo animals get it all the time. Do you know wild animals never get cancer? Zoo animals get it all the time. See, for years, people died of diseases. Beriberi, pellagra, rickets, they were all vitamin deficiency diseases. Indians knew about that. They take the willow tree, peel the bark off, scrape the inside, and chew on it. Get rid of scurvy. Vitamin C found all over the world. The Bible says in Psalm 104, God gave herb for the service of man, and bread to strengthen man's heart. Now, there's a strange verse. Does bread strengthen your heart? Well, it used to. You know, 100 years ago, they had to bake the bread fresh every day because it would go bad. So they started taking out the vitamin E, the lecithin, and the omega-3 fatty acids, and sure enough, the bread lasts much longer. A lot of the brown bread you get is just white bread with brown food coloring. If it doesn't rot in a couple days, you don't want it. See, there are two philosophies of health and medicine. One philosophy is based on evolution teaching, which says your body's nothing but chemicals that got together by chance, so you add more chemicals. This is called drug therapy. It comes from an evolutionary preconception. If you have a headache and you go to the doctor, you say, "Oh, doctor, I got a headache." He says, "Here, take an aspirin." When my son was real small, he had about 21 little seed warts on his hand. And I was living in Texas, and I told one of the guys in our church, or no, in Illinois, and I said, "Hey, I'm going to go get my son to the doctor and get the seed warts burned off." And they said, "Why? Why don't you have him take zinc?" I said, "Zinc?" He said, "Yeah, take some zinc tablets. They'll go away in a few weeks." Sure enough, all of them disappear. It's a zinc deficiency. By the way, we're poisoning ourselves by putting fluoride in our toothpaste and in our water supply. Absolute poisonous stuff. See, the other philosophy of medicine is based on creation. God said, every beast of the earth and every fowl of the air and everything that creepeth upon the earth, wherein there is life, I've given every green herb for meat. Did you know all the animals before the flood ate plants? Intelligence was not a prerequisite to live on my street, brother, believe me, okay?